Greetings, and welcome to Ross Walks. I'm Ross, and this is me walking. This being the first video on the channel, I thought I'd explain what exactly you're about to see. I've been hiking for years. It's a passion of mine going back to my childhood, and my Instagram page, William Ross Hurl, which you should definitely check out, has focused on a lot of my adventures in the past few years. As a Knoxville native and avid hiker, people have asked me a ton of questions about the Smokies and East Tennessee's many trail options. They've enjoyed my pictures and narratives, and upon pitching this idea, I received enough positive feedback to give it a go. And don't worry, most of the video won't be what's going on right now, the whole me talking thing. I'll only jump in when there's something interesting enough to see. The camera angle will also probably rise a bit in the future, happy for suggestions regarding the technical side. Rather, you can go about whatever it is you want to get done, and I'll just be here if you want to look at something else. I know I love having something in between music and a podcast from time to time, so hopefully that's what this can be. You get a few things done, I'll just be hiking. There's even a bit of quiet music from time to time. You can find information on the talented creators in the description below. Anyway, I'll skip that spiel in future videos. For now, enjoy the Bullhead Trail, a few minutes outside Gatlinburg. This is one of my absolute favorites in the Great Smoky Mountain National Park. While it's right next to one of the most popular hikes, Rainbow Falls, the Bullhead sees little use. Yet the panoramic views it offers are no less than magnificent. We will see more than a few of those today. So I hope you enjoy this wonderful corner of the world. I'll be back in a few minutes, once there's something interesting enough for me to mention. You probably didn't hear the snapping of a twig that took my vision left, but I happened to spot a deer just a few dozen feet off trail. White-tailed deer are the most common species in North America, and the state of Tennessee is home to an estimated 900,000, according to the Tennessee Wildlife Resource Agency. Interestingly, they are not often found in herds, preferring solitude outside of mating season. That isn't to say herds don't exist, but most prefer a lonesome life, and appear like this doe, by herself, deep in the forest. You may have also heard a rapid knocking in the distance. This is caused by a pileated woodpecker, the largest species among its kind. While rare in some parts of the U.S., the Smoky Mountains offer prime habitat for the crow-sized bird, and they are fairly common. I even got to see the likely culprit of these aggressive knocks on my way down trail, as you can see here. If you listen carefully, you'll hear it again in just a moment as the hike continues. If you're wondering what that sign said, it is cautioning against reckless behavior regarding burn damage on the Bullhead. On November 23rd, 2016, one day before Thanksgiving, a massive, devastating inferno sparked on the Chimney Tops Trail in the park. Most suspect it was the result of two teenagers playing with matches. However, the charges against them were eventually dropped due to lack of evidence. At first, the flames were an inconvenience, interlaced in terrain you'll see plenty of in this video. However, when increasingly dry weather and extreme winds struck the area days later, they went from unfortunate to tragic, spreading beyond park boundaries into the town of Gatlinburg below. The fires raged for 21 days, and according to a 5-year anniversary story by WVLT, 14 people were killed and 191 were injured. Flames destroyed nearly 2,500 homes and left an estimated $2 billion in damages. Over 11,000 acres were burned inside the Great Smoky Mountain National Park, more than 17,000 in total. The Bullhead and its trail were at the heart of the flames, and you'll see the mark they left behind in the skeletons of trees, scorching of rock, and clearing of underbrush, all visible years later. But if you're looking for a silver lining, the reduced foliage has created some of the most stunning vistas in the park, and there remains a wonderful opportunity to see how a forest can recover after such a destructive event. For now, the burnt rock and dead trees later on in the video serve as a haunting reminder of how great our impact can be on beautiful places such as the Smokies, and how, no matter the ferocity of our intrusions, nature has a way of returning to balance when given the chance. Thank you. It's views like this one that make me wonder how so few people hike this trail. Here we look across the Cherokee Orchard Valley, just east of Gatlinburg, a small, bustling tourist town, barely visible in the distance. You may have noticed the distinct lack of hikers here despite the proximity to Gatlinburg, one of the park's most popular trails and good weather at the beginning of peak season in America's most visited national park. This trend will continue. And that's the true secret of Great Smoky Mountain National Park. There are so many incredible places, such as this, people simply don't know about, and thus they are appreciated by few. But I don't mind. There's something enchanting about having a trail to yourself, feeling that you're truly alone. I really can't recommend the Bullhead enough. We've already seen so many amazing things, and we're hardly a mile into the journey. Remember when I mentioned the forest's recovery from fires less than a decade ago? Here is a prime example. This is a Table Mountain pine, one that has perhaps the most frightening pine cones in existence, and a fascinating adaptation. They prefer well-drained acidic soil and grow best on mountaintops, where most plants struggle. In fact, they are often found in the ashy remains of burned environments, their seeds germinating best after exposure to extreme heat. These defiant little trees are often the first spotted after such events, and have thrived following the infamous Gatlinburg fires. Eventually, they will be replaced by broadleaves. In a few hundred years, this will be old-growth forest, much like the pockets of unburned habitat you will see elsewhere on the trail. But for now, these exposed ridgelines belong to the Table Mountains, alongside other lowland conifers, and our journey will take us ever higher on the flanks of LeConte. There's just something so magical about these mountains. The feeling that Wait.
Hello? Hiya.
And that was my mom. Let's just continue. If you're wondering why they call them the Smoky Mountains, then wonder no more. Above, High to the right, you can see thick clouds hanging on top of Mount LeConte. These are caused when moisture from the west hits the sudden rise in elevation, condenses, and cools. It is also why the weather here tends to be much more extreme than that of the valley, though not as wild as the slightly smaller White Mountains in the Appalachians' northern reaches of New Hampshire. The mist offers an incredible accent to these vistas, giving them an almost mysterious quality. We'll just have to hope things don't get too mysterious. Otherwise, we may not have much to see at our planned stop. For now, we can only continue.
goodness.
After a short break, it's time to keep Oh. And we're not going to leave the food behind. Okay, let's try that again. Ooh. What's about to happen will be difficult for you to see, but if spotting a deer wasn't enough already, a large black bear took me by surprise in the trail not far ahead. You're also going to see how one should handle this sort of situation in the park.
Holy crap. Oh dear. That's not great. Hey, bear! Hey, bear! Hey, bear! Head on out of here. Walk and pass, bear. Walk and pass. On the trail. You just stay down there. Still walking. Oh, that was easy. Knock on wood. Too. Goodness me.
While a good way to get the adrenaline pumping, black bears are rarely a danger to humans, and if you make your presence known with enough space for them to react, you're almost certainly in no danger. The truth is, you're more likely to be injured in your car on the way to the park than by a black bear. And, as in-person me will explain, it's not my first encounter.
Well, certainly not my first encounter with a bear on the trail. Happens more often than you'd actually think. At this incredible view in the background. The camera really doesn't do this sort of thing justice. It's a lot to be in. I do wish we had a clearer day, but it's why they call them the Smoky Mountains, so there you go. Yeah, black bears tend to not be very dangerous. They very rarely attack humans, and even if they do get aggressive, it's really fatal. What's interesting is the first recorded death in the park from a bear attack wasn't until after the year 2000. It is very, very rare that they become aggressive, especially if you don't sneak up on them. So if you keep facing them, make sure you stand your ground, make as much noise as you can, look as big and scary as you can. 99 times out of 100, they just run away. We're pretty big to them. They don't want to mess with us. So, stay safe out there.
This isn't even the closest I've been to a black bear in the park either. Once, along Anthony Creek, I came around the corner of a shelter to find one less than 20 feet away from me, just on the other side. We locked eyes for a few seconds, both a bit stunned, and then I told it to leave. It ran into the forest with no issue. Stand your ground, look as large as you can, and yell. Under no circumstances should you leave food in your tent. Approach a bear, try to feed it, take pictures with it, smuggle it into your car, ride it. All of these actions are highly dangerous. In any case, let's continue. And after just under 3 miles, we've reached our destination. This trail continues to the 6,593-foot summit of Mount LeConte, but we won't be making that trek today. The structure here is known as the Pulpit, a large rock cairn built by the Civilian Conservation Corps in the 1930s. This team of young men built most of the park's constructions, though the Pulpit wasn't a sanctioned idea. In fact, the team here decided it would be useful to stand on for views over what was once a ridge of dense heaths until the fires of 2016. Thus it remains almost a century later, with some help from hikers along the way. The tradition is to leave a stone on the cairn after you enjoy it, but it seemed a lot of hikers decided to cover the top with small rocks, so we'll call my relocation-based repairs adequate for my participation. As you can see, the views leave much to be desired. We've just passed into the cloud deck spotted earlier. However, if you notice mists in the mountains, moving as fast as these are, especially if you haven't been in them long, try waiting a few minutes. Indeed, by the time I finish my lunch, I climb back on top of the Pulpit for a view of this. Thank you. winding vista looks across both the northwest into the Cherokee Orchard and Roaring Fork regions of the park, and southeast toward Sugarland Mountain. To the direct east is Mount LeConte, disappearing into the clouds, perhaps not to be seen for the entire day by the looks of things. This hike produced a few incredible pictures you can see here, including one of the ridgeline where I took another picture of the very spot we're standing now. The Sugarland Mountain Trail is another incredible undiscovered treasure, full of history and truly thought-provoking views. In fact, among these pictures of peak autumn foliage, you can see the very spot we're standing indicated here. For now, I'll let you see a few more of the shots. You never know when one of these amazing sights will be your last, so always slow down and enjoy them whenever you can. Finally, just before it was time to go, I got to see perhaps the most amazing part of the journey. Just as fast as the view cleared, the mountains hit it again. The video you're seeing hasn't been sped up or tampered with in any way. This is real-time footage of how quickly conditions change here. And in so many ways, it's a work of art we simply can't replicate, only hope to witness. And that is where our time together comes to an end. What an adventure this has been. Thank you so much for joining me on this little expedition. If you liked it, consider spreading the word. Even something as small as a like is a huge help. I don't know if I'll continue this or not. It really depends on if you want to see it, so please, leave a comment saying you would like the series to continue. I loved putting this together. And if you have any suggestions for future videos, whether it be format, content, or anything else, I'm happy to take it into account. I hope you have a wonderful day, evening, night, or whatever other side of time you consider yourself an inhabitant of at the moment. And please, join me again for another adventure on Ross Walks.